just to know you and to make you know me. Lift your name on high, more than just survive. We were made to thrive. Oh.
and greet your neighbors, especially speak to someone you might not have talked to yet.
Good morning. How are you?
Right.
Morning, Richard. How are you?
I gave you Nathan's their website.
Right.
Did you check it?
I've already checked it out.
Pretty awesome stuff, isn't it?
It is awesome.
Yeah. They're coming for Thanksgiving, so.
Awesome.
If you guys want to stop by, that's fine.
Okay.
You know, just give me a time.
Okay.
I'll make sure we're there.
Okay.
Yeah. I can give Ed his graduation present.
Oh.
Yeah.
Hey,
Zach.
You snuck up, got up front this morning.
I know. Well, I was looking around.
The morning good one again.
I've been in the morning.
Good. See you.
Andy.
Let's talk about it. Listen.
All right, as we enter into our prayer time, I was going to have you, just three people, shout out something you're thankful for. Your son? Your husband?
And my daughter.
Gene.
Yeah? Gene? Okay. Awesome. Family. So sometimes when we have our prayer time, we just think of all of our burdens, but it's a great time to also think of all those things that we're thankful for as we come in here as thankful people. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Loving God, this morning we are so thankful to be in worship. We're thankful to be in worship with such awesome people beside us as well. But God, as we are thankful, we also, every one of us came in here with burdens, and you know what those burdens are. We lift those up to you. And God, we lift up those who couldn't be here as well, those who are sick or just unable to come. We lift them up, and you know what their needs are as well. God, we pray that through the rest of the service that you will speak through the message and the songs. We ask all this in your name. Amen.
You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. If you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies. Trying to fill the same old holes inside. There's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains.
All right. The scripture today is taken from Matthew's Gospel, the 25th chapter, verses 14 through actually 30. I'm not sure what's in the bulletin, but I'm stopping at 30. Jesus is speaking, and he says, "For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I've made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." And the one who had 2 talents also came forward, saying, "Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, "Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours." But his master replied, "You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I do not sow and gather where I do not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. And from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I'm going to start with a little clip on the screen.
Thank you. sudden. And that's just one side of me.
Okay, what's the dream?
I'm trying to be a professional singer.
And why hasn't it worked out so far, Susan?
I've not been given the chance before, but here's hoping it will change.
Okay, and who would you like to be as successful as?
Elaine Page.
Elaine Page.
What are you going to sing tonight?
I'm going to sing I Dreamed a Dream from the Miserables. And she went on to sing with Elaine Page. You can go look on YouTube. But I think that partly when we watch someone like that sing and just has the voice of an angel, I realize we can be very intimidated to even try to sing. And like I said, some of us should know better than to get up on Wednesday night and sing karaoke. You won't see me. Honest. Unless you want, I might get a lot of money, like yeah. Andy said, for y'all to get me to stop singing. But perhaps when we read the scripture that I read, we think about having that kind of talent, that Susan Boyle, beautiful, lovely voice talent, and we think, I don't have that, and so I'm not even going to open my mouth. The word talent in the scripture, though, it is where we get our word talent from, if you look at the etymology of words and where that came from. But that's not what it meant in the scripture. It referred to money. And a talent was about 15 years worth of wages. So the first guy had 5, the second had 2, and the last one had 1. The problem with parables is that sometimes we don't get the point. Because they're not meant to be easily accessible, I don't think. And we don't understand the context, because it was a different culture that Jesus was speaking in and speaking into at that time. And so if we try to make this parable fit some kind of allegory, a lot of times we equate Jesus with this harsh master. That doesn't seem like Jesus to me. And sometimes we think it's about money management. I had somebody that told me, I mean, he quit ministry to go become a money manager because he thought that's what God really wanted him to do. Maybe it was. But I think that if we look at this scripture too literally, we miss the meaning of it. And Adam Hamilton likes to say that when Jesus uses hyperbole, that sort of exaggeration that Jesus likes to use in parables, Jesus is wanting us to take him seriously, but maybe not literally. So if we look at this parable and try and understand the context of it, where it is in the scripture, if you go read right before this, there's a parable of the bridesmaids, I think is what it's called, where they have an oil lamp and they run out of oil and they have to go buy, some of them have to go buy oil and others. It's about what to do while you're waiting on Jesus to come back. And I think that's what this parable speaks into. What are we supposed to be doing when we're waiting for the return of Christ? For the early disciples, this was a big question because they had expected Jesus to return soon in their lifetime. And when that didn't happen, they were wondering what they were supposed to do. And this parable speaks into that. It's not so much about financial money management as it is about what we do with what God has gifted us. What are the things that we do with the abilities that God has given us? How do we use them? Are we afraid of using them and so we bury them? Or do we invest them and try to grow the kingdom? If we're to be faithful in the meanwhile, between this time when Jesus has gone to be with God and when Jesus returns, what are we supposed to do with all those things that God has given us? We are to be about the work of kingdom building. We all have a part to play in bringing God's kingdom to earth. In the sense of investing our gifts so that other people know of God's love and grace and mercy. Now, the servant that is condemned in this parable was immobilized by fear and unwilling to use what the master had entrusted to him. This isn't in my sermon, but I'll tell you this. This is why you don't want me to sing. When I was in high school, I took a drama class. And part of that was we had to get up and sing a song. Well, I am not a soloist. I've sung in choirs because there's lots of voices and I just have to blend in and hide my voice with everybody else's. But I had to get up on stage, and so I decided I would sing Raindrops Are Falling on My Head, which anyone younger than the age of 50 maybe doesn't even know what that song is. But I loved it. And I got a raincoat, an umbrella, and I got up there and I sang my song. I got a D. It's bad. Because the teacher said, because I was so nervous that you couldn't understand what I was saying. You couldn't. He said, you could have almost spoken it and it would have been fine. But I was so fearful because I know I don't have a great solo voice. And I let that fear overwhelm my words. Too often, we are overwhelmed with fear that we don't step out in faith and use gifts that God has given us. What we do in the meanwhile, when Jesus is not here with us, is we need to take stock of what gifts and abilities we do have and how we can use them for God in this world. What is it that God wants us to do that might involve taking a risk with figuring out what it is that maybe you've never done before, but you think you have this, maybe you do have a voice and could sing in the choir with the praise band, but you're a little nervous about being up here because I might make fun of your guitar. But God gives you abilities. Do we bury those abilities or do we use them in ways that further God's grace in this world? What is it that keeps us from using those gifts? Is it that fear that someone might laugh at you because maybe you don't have the greatest voice? I think that's where it's important to have Christian friends that can discern with you what those gifts are, and that can be honest with you and say, you know, maybe you ought to sing in the choir, not by yourself. Or maybe you can use this gift in this way. Have you ever thought about that? Maybe you're a teacher. Maybe you could teach children if you're too worried about teaching adults. Because I can tell you, every Sunday school teacher I know will tell you they learn more when they have to prepare to teach than they do if they're just sitting in a class. Because you feel like you have to know it better than anybody in the room. Sometimes God's given us abilities that we haven't figured out yet. So I said I was going to tell you I'm going to send an email this week. I'm going to send you a link, if you're on our email, that goes to a spiritual gifts inventory that helps you think about what you like to do and what you might have the abilities to do. And it's just a way for you to think about how God might want you to step out and use those abilities in a way that blesses not just this congregation, but the wider world. A few years ago, I was preparing a sermon, and I was using voice to text. I was just kind of talking to myself in the car, and I said that phrase, wider world. My voice text, when I read it, said, white water. And I was like, white water? What word was that? And I realized it was wider world. Well, if you're somebody who likes to canoe or to raft, you know what white water is. It's the rapids. And it's the water's white because you know there's a ripple there. There's probably a rock or something underneath that maybe you want to be careful there. But you also know that the white water is the best part. It's the most fun of the ride because you bounce around a little bit and you have fun. So, white water can be scary. Going out into the wider world and offering the gifts that God has given us can be a scary thing, but it's also a thrilling thing. I think about Susan Boyle standing on that huge stage. She's 47 years old, and she's never had the opportunity to stand in front of an audience like that. I can't imagine how nerve-wracking that might be. I mean, preaching even to this many people makes me nervous. But all those people, but then the thrill of seeing all of them stand up and actually acknowledge that what she was doing was beautiful and lovely. When we risk sharing what we have, we can experience that kind of affirmation that, yeah, this is what I'm supposed to do. Sometimes it's not always like that. Sometimes it's a bumpy path. Sometimes we get thrown out of the canoe or the raft and have to climb back in. But God is still there with us because each of us has been gifted in some way. A lot of us just don't know what that is, and we're not sure how to use it so that others might be blessed. But that is what, to me, this parable is about. It's about offering ourselves and taking a risk and stepping out in faith in a new way with something that we feel that God has given us to share. Not to keep to ourselves, not to bury in the backyard, but to share not just in this space, in this church, but beyond the walls as well with the world. Because we live in a world that needs to know of God's grace and love and mercy. And what does it mean for us as a congregation to step out in faith, to do something risky, and to share all of who we are with our community and with our world? There's a word in the scripture that says, out of abundance. I can't remember exactly what the verse said. But too often, we think of abundance as something we want to accumulate for ourselves. But when Jesus talks about abundant life, he's talking about a life that is filled full with God's grace and mercy and love and that connects us to others, that helps us to reach out in love and grace and mercy. So I invite you, as we, during this season of Thanksgiving, this season when we often take stock of our blessings, that you might take stock of what abilities God has given you. What are your gifts? And how can you use those for God's kingdom? Here and beyond. That you might truly go out into the white water and step out in faith, knowing that Jesus is with you. You are not alone. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks that you are with us every step of our journey. Help us to take risk for your sake, that we might offer our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness for your glory, so that others might know of your love, your mercy, and your grace. God, fill us, renew us, and help us to step out in faith, knowing that we can experience your abundant grace. In Jesus' name.
I invite you to stand again if we'll sing together one more time this morning. Life is worth the living.
and life is worth the living just because He lives.
Might you go forth to live out your abilities for God's kingdom. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.